Welcome to the second lecture this week of Scientific Python. Last Tuesday we talked a little about we talked a lot about the Python data model and how a lot of the behavior that you observe in the Python language is just are just syntactic sugar around method calls to objects that you have and how you can implement this behavior on your own objects so that they behave just as native languages, just as native objects in the language. So we talked about how you make nice string representations for stuff, how you can override operators, how you can make things iterable, and then how you can hide getter and setter logic from the user of your classes using properties. And then we talked a bit about generators as well and context managers. And then finally a bit about exceptions and decorators, how you can transparently add some behavior to the functions that you have. And then finally, so we talked about lambda expressions, how you can define anonymous functions that are just anonymous functions, how you can make small throwaway functions that you can make that you can use to parameterize other functions again. So this time we'll just finish off the lecture, and then I think we have some time for you to start with the homework. So let's get started. So a very nice feature of the Python language are so-called comprehensions. So comprehensions are just a syntax to create collections very idiomatically. So what you would usually do when you say, let's say we want to have a list of squared numbers. So we have a list of numbers and now we want to find out what is the square of all of those numbers. What you would do in languages that don't support comprehension features, by the way, is this big enough to read or should I make it? Okay. So what you then do is you would just iterate over the collection and then you would make a new empty collection, and then in each iteration you append whatever you want to do to this new collection that you have here. However, the comprehension simply greatly simplifies the syntax. So what you can do is you say, okay, for I in my original collection, I want to do this expression, and then you just surround this whole expression with the literal for the new collection that you want to make. And then you can just assign this to a variable, and this is basically equivalent to what we have to the code up here. So instead of these three lines, we just need this one, and it is not really any less readable. It's actually more readable because we don't have so much fuss around it. So this is very, very recommended way. If you want to create a new collection from an old collection, then you can use comprehension. So the general syntax for comprehension is the following. You say, okay, around the comprehension, you have the literal for the new collection that you want to create. So just doing this would generally just create an empty list, right? And then you say, like, expression for element in original collection. And then, optionally, you can have a filter expression at the end. And we'll see this later. So what we can do, for example, when we want to use this filter expression is, let's say we have our original collection is a list of tuples, and we have as the first element of each tuple we have an integer, and as the second element we have a boolean, true or false. And now let's say we want to filter this collection, we just want to get all the numbers from the tuples that have a true or as the second element in the tuple here. So then again, without comprehension, we would do something like, okay, let's make first initialize a new collection, then iterate over the old one and say, okay, if the second element is not true, or no, if the second element is true, then we append the first element. But with collection, we can, again, greatly simplify this. So we simply say, okay, again, for element in our original collection, do the following expression. So give us the first element of whatever comes out of original values here. And then only do this if the second element is true, or if this expression evaluates to true. And by doing this, let's just have a look at this. So here we see, okay, we only have the values that have a true as the second element. So here 1, 4, and 7, and this just is exactly the same thing to do. Then there might be occasions where you do not just want to filter, but you want to do something else in the case that the filter condition fails. So in this case, what is often a bit confusing, then you do not put the if at the end of the comprehension, but at the beginning. And the reason for this is that this is not really a filter, but this is just a ternary expression. So this is just, so to say, just a common comprehension without the additional filter, but using this as an expression to put in the new collection. So we already saw that we can, like, that it's in the second week, that it's legal syntax to write this if true, else 5, so to say, then we get a 1, and if we put a false here, then we get a 5. So this is just a ternary expression that you can have. Okay, if this condition fails, then give us this value, otherwise give us this value. And we can just also use this here, and we say, okay, if the second element in our original collection is true, then give us the first, otherwise give us 0. So, and by doing this, we would simply substitute all the values in the original collection that have a false as the second element here by a 0. So just keep this in mind. If you want to have also an else, then you should not put this at the end of the collection, but then you need to use a ternary expression instead. Yeah, so comprehensions do exist for other kinds of collections, so not just for lists. So we can also put the literals for a dictionary around our comprehension. So we put the curly braces here, and then we use the following a bit modified syntax. So we do not simply say for expression in our original collection, but we say for key colon value in our original expression, in our original collection. And again, these two could be any kinds of expressions here. And by doing this, we can simply create a dictionary that maps the original numbers in 1 to 5 to their squares. So the result of this will be then looked like this. And again, there's also a generalization to generators. So instead of defining a generator function with a yield in the body, you can simply do the following. You just write a comprehension, and then instead of putting collection literals around it, so instead of square or curly braces, you simply put normal parentheses around it. And this will in fact give you a generator. So when we do this, we can assign this to a value. And then we can say, okay, and this is now a generator object. We can call next on this to get the next value. And we can also just print, convert it to a list, and then all the complete generator will be used up and converted to a list. So if you just need to make a quick generator, you can also use this syntax. And if you want to, for example, create a set where there's no, I believe, no comprehension syntax for this, for sets, then you could also consider doing something like this. So first make, or it's just, so first make a generator, and then just pass the generator to the initializer of another collection, and then you get a set instead. And there you can note that you do not really need extra parentheses. So looking at this here, this is the constructor for the set, and this is really just a comprehension. So we do not have any additional literals around it, it will be interpreted as a generator in this case. Okay, yeah, this, I wonder actually now if I missed something, but I think not, because this is already the last chapter of today's lecture here. So now we talk a bit about strings and format strings. So in Python, you often deal with strings when you'll deal with any kind of text. And then first, let's look at some useful string methods that you can use. So for example, there's something called strip, which will strip away any white space, which is often useful when you get some data from someone else, and the data is often dirty. So first thing you might want to do is eliminate like stupid mistakes as having additional white space. So let's look at this. You see, it's just the original string with the white space removed on both sides. So then there's also L strip and R strip, which is for left and right. So if you only want to strip a certain value at one end of the string, And then you can also pass additional values here to strip if you want to strip. So for example, if we have an A here and we want to only strip A's, let's see if this works. Yeah, then we would only strip the A away. So then there's also split, which is also nice. So split takes also a string, and then it will just cut our original string in pieces wherever split finds the string that we passed here. So wherever we find this here, this will be replaced, and we will cut, so to say, away here. And then it will, by default, I think, convert it to a list. So let's look at the result here. So if this is our original string here, we get a list now containing only this, this, and this, and we see that it's of type list. And we could also like split by, not by the white space, and then the white space would be included here in the strings. And then there's also the, so to say, the other way around option. If you have a list of strings or an iterable of strings, then you can again put them together. That is to join them. So this is a method that you also call in the string. So let's assume that we have this string here, which is just comma white space, and now we have our splitted values. And now we say just join them on the string. So for all the strings in our original list here, it will concatenate this at the end of each string, except for the last one, and it will create a new string again from this. So this is kind of the inverse operator of split then. And this is often useful because you don't get something appended at the end, so you don't have to think much about logic. Okay, but if it's the last string, then do this or so. You can simply use join. And then another thing which often pops up is so-called format strings. So let's say you have a data structure and now you want to wrap this somehow in a string or want to represent a message including this data structure. And now you need some way to format this data into a string. So an example would be if we say, okay, we have an integer, we have a floating point number, in this case it's pi, and then we also have a string. And now we want to print a message that says, okay, this is an int, is this, a float is this, and then a string is this. So, and the way you can do this, I mean, you could, so the simplest way, maybe like version 0, which we did not include it here, would be to convert every object to a string and then just concatenate it with the original string. So, right, we could write something like, let's see, like this, and then say string of an integer or so. And this would also work, right? But this is very ugly because when you have a lot of data that you want to somehow put in a string, now you need to continue, we need to put the next string here and then go on like this, and this gets very out of hand quickly. So instead we have this format syntax where we say, okay, we have a placeholder here, and this placeholder represents a certain type of data structure. So for example, %d represents an integer, %f represents a float, and %s simply represents a string. And then we can use the modulo operator on the string. So the modulo operator is overwritten for the string objects, and we can pass a tuple into it, and then we get like all these placeholders replaced by the values that we have here. So this syntax is probably familiar to people who know C or C++, because it is inherited from there. There's a like a printf function or so that uses exactly the same syntax, and it is probably used under the hood here as well. However, the problem with this is like this is the oldest string format way that you can encounter, and for this you always have to remember, okay, which letter actually maps to which kind of data type. So now, okay, now I have a float. Okay, was it F? Was it, I don't know, was it L, if it is long or whatever. So this is the oldest thing, and this is just for like having you seen that you have seen this once, but I would not really recommend to use it. So then there's the version 2 of formatting strings, which is already a lot nicer and also more powerful. So in this case, what we do here is we have a string, and instead of this percent, some letter placeholders, we simply have empty curly braces as placeholders. And then what we do is we call .format on the string, so .format is now a method on string objects, and then we pass as a as arguments simply the values that we want to format. And here, like the first value that we pass to format will now replace the first placeholder, and the second will replace the second. So in this case here, we have again our dictionary of people here. We have three people, and then we say, okay, for each person in people, let's print the formatted version of this name is this years old. So this will look like this, as we expected. And this already gives you the advantage that you do not have to remember what letters you need to use for different kinds of objects. And what you can also do is, instead of just having empty placeholders, you can give the placeholders names. So you can say name is age years old, and then you, instead of simply passing raw arguments here, or like just comma separated arguments, you pass keyword arguments. So you say, okay, age should be this and name should be this. And this gives you the opportunity to do not have to heed the order of the placeholders that you define. So we see that we pass age as the first argument, but because we tell explicitly that person at age should be age, Python will know where to put the values, and then we get the same result. And this makes it a bit more readable. And in general, if you have a dictionary already, you can also use this double star syntax that will automatically unpack a dictionary as keyword arguments, and this will be equivalent to doing the above. You have also a lot of possible format options that you can use when you use the format method. So for example, you have before you, for the actual value, you have so-called modifiers, I think, that you can use to change the way the object will be rendered as a string. So for example, we can use, you need to put a colon then first, and then you say, okay, let's have the greater sign, that means it will be write justified text, and then it will be 10 characters long, and we get a 2.f floating precision for our floating numbers here. So we make a bunch of numbers here, which will be those, and then we print all of those, and then we get a write justified text where we only have like two places after the comma here, and the whole string will be like 10 characters long. So you can easily make a string like this if you want to. So this is like version 2 of string formatting. So this was introduced in Python 3 only. So this is like, sometimes you see still the old syntax because people want to keep Python 2 compatibility for some reason. I would rather recommend to break Python 2 compatibility in as many ways as you can, so no one will try to use their code with Python 2. And a good way to do this again is to use syntax that was only introduced in Python 3.6, so that no one can use your code with a version lower than 3.6. And this is f-strings. So f-strings are really the nicest way to format strings, because you don't really, it's really the like least verbose way to do it, and also the most readable. So what we do here, we simply prefix a string that we want to format with an F. So before you put the parentheses, you put an F, and then you say, okay, here's my string, and when you want to, where you want to put the format, or put up the object that you want to format, again, you use curly braces, and then you put the name of the variable that the object that you want to format there is bound to. So you do not need to do any additional parameter parsing or call any function. You simply first define the object that you want to format, and then you say, then you refer to it here with a variable. Then you can do stuff like this. And this is the most readable way, because then you can really simply read, he said his name is, and then name represents like the general thing that you have in your program somewhere, and you don't have to do anything more. And in this curly braces, you can basically execute any valid Python code. So you can also execute functions there, or any kind of expression. So you could write strings like 12 plus 16 is 12 plus 16, and then magically you will get the answer to this. And you can also use the same format modifiers that you know from the dot format method. So for example, we can have stuff like put the width and precision here, and we can also define this width variables first, and then we get something like, okay, now we have this value formatted with a precision of 4, but only 2 here in this case. Well, let's see. This is a bit strange, but this may be because, so at least like the string is 10 wide. So this worked out. So, but you can use also other format modifiers that you find when you look for how to format stuff, but I would really recommend using this for string formatting if you need to format any strings. And yeah, with this, as expected, we are early done with the lecture. So are there any questions regarding like this week's contents right now? If not, then I will just show you where you get the homework, and I will also then stay here for the rest of the lecture. So if you encounter any problems or questions doing the homework, then you can work on that together. So we have like on StudIP, on the lecture, we have a new announcement where it says homework and bonus. So, and because we have the Easter holidays, we'll have some special Easter homework for you, which doesn't have anything to do with Easter, but you can get one more point right now. So in best case, you already have 4 homeworks of 10 done by next week. So let's maybe just quickly introduce the homework. So yeah, I already accepted my homework, that's good. So there's one normal and one bonus, but in general it doesn't matter which you would like to do. You can do, obviously, the best thing you should do both, but you can also just do one, and bonus is not really harder than the normal one, I would say. And you just get the same, you just get 1 point like for doing either of those. So homework one will be about implementing a idiomatic matrix class. So we learned a lot about the standard operators that you can override to make objects behave in a nice way. And in this homework, you should do this for a class called matrix. And in the end, I'll just make this a bit bigger, I guess. You should get behavior like where you have a matrix class, and then you should be able to instantiate this with a nested list, or also with a factory method. So fill it with all the same values. And then it should print nicely. You should be able to read out data, but not assign any data. And then you should also be able to assign values to specific entries in those matrix. So this is something that we did not directly talk about, but for this you need to override the get item and set item methods. And you can practice to look up this in the Python documentation, how this works, and I think it's not difficult. And in the end, you should also implement scalar multiplication so that your matrix can be multiplied with the scalar, and also the other way around. In this case, you do not need to implement matrix multiplication. We'll just assume that scaling matrices is all that we want to do. And then, so for this, you have time until next Thursday, 12, so just a week again. And for the other, you have a bit more time, so until the 30s, so you have like until the Tuesday after next week. So, and this will be about, it's just like a mixture of different things that we did this week. So it will be something about using decorators and exceptions. It will be something about using I/O and counting characters in a file, and a bit about lambda functions and about writing a generator. And yeah, I would recommend to start with any of those, which either which of you like better, but then also stick with the one, because you only get a point if you actually finish or make all the tests pass. And if you try both and only do half of them both, then you don't get any point, and this would be sad. Yeah. Okay, so with this, feel free to start, and if you have any kind of problems, just raise your hand and ask.